thank you for being here to worship with us this morning. As we celebrate the Advent season, as we come, hopefully with joyful hearts, but we know the reality of the world is that our hearts are not always as joyful as we would wish they would be. And so we come this morning knowing that God is faithful, that He sees us, that He knows your circumstances, He knows your situation this morning. And honestly, it's okay if you're not okay. The Redeemer has to be, we have to be a place as a church where it's okay not to be okay. We just want to know that in Christ we have hope, and that we are not alone in our circumstances. And so, if you haven't been with us before, we do let the kids stay in for the first couple songs. We do that intentionally. We know it can be rambunctious. It's okay. We want them to grow up knowing they're a part of the overall church family. And they're singing songs with us. They're asking us questions about what words mean and who it is that we're raising our hands to and why we do certain things. It's an opportunity to just to grow and to teach and to disciple them. Prior to the sermon, those kids kindergarten and down have classes down this hallway for the remainder of the service. Our elementary age kids have a class every other week, so elementary kids, y'all are in the service this week. There's some worship notebooks over in the window if you need to grab one to help kind of follow along with the service this morning. Just one quick announcement. We will have a Christmas Eve service at 5:30 on Friday, which is Christmas Eve, the 24th. It's the one service we do promise to keep in a tight frame. We start at 5:30 and we're done before 6:30, so that you'll have the rest of the evening for friends, for family, for meal, and for those things. Let me pray for us, and we will enter a time of worship. Father, thank you for your mercy. God, thank you for your kindness to us. Thank you that you see us. God, that you are ministering. God, that you are giving grace in ways that we see and are very aware of. Lord, that you're giving grace in ways that right now feel very foreign and maybe even that we're just ignorant of right now. God, thank you that you are doing far more than we know. God, would you draw our wandering hearts and our wandering minds back to you. God, this morning would we see the glory of who you are and leave as people who long to worship with all of our lives, the risen Savior. God, would you speak, your church is listening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promises of God with prayer. We light this candle in hope. We light this candle for peace. And we light this candle in joy. Rejoice, for our Lord is coming into the darkness of oppression's exile to lead us home, as we hear in Isaiah 35:1-10.
The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God.
Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance and with terrible recompense. He will come and save you.
Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp, and the grass shall become reeds and rushes.
A highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not travel on it, but it shall be for God's people. No traveler, not even fools, shall go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come upon it. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion.
laughter's joy over your abundant restoration. Thank you that you are coming for us to lead us home along your way, Jesus Christ. Amen. You guys stand with us and let's sing together this morning. He has come.
Thank you.
from everlasting to everlasting. We have nothing to fear because you are with us today. Lord, would you be with us and near in this place this morning? By your word through Ecclesiastes, would you correct us where we've been vain or prideful, where we've put other things in front of you, where we've given priority to things that surely do not matter in eternity? And would you encourage us, Lord, to walk in your peace today? In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can have a seat. Our little guys are dismissed this way down the hall for childcare. Like Jeremy said, our big kids do have a class in here today, or don't have class. They'll be in here with us today for the sermon. There's some worship that was over here at the window, if they would like to have something to follow along, do a little fun, or for searching.
This is what satisfies us. morning, what satisfies you? And one of the interesting things we're going to have to do in Ecclesiastes is we will look at it in pieces over the week in multiple sermons, but really Ecclesiastes needs to be seen both in piece and as a whole. And so there's a part of it that we will be left wanting a little bit week in and week out until we have worked our way through the whole book. Asking the question of what satisfies you is particularly poignant during the Christmas season, right? As you have kids or grandkids or those around you that you will be looking at going, hey, what are you asking for Christmas, right? That's a question that everybody's kids get asked this time of year. Or maybe you go back to your own childhood, right? And that first time, right, when you really remember, like, not just I want something because I want presents, but I want, like, there's this, like, you're willing to give up future Christmases. You don't really mean that, right? But you make that promise, right? That thing, what do I have to do to get it? Whether it was, right, a bike, whether that was maybe your first gun, right? Some item that felt like I'm probably not quite be getting this, but there's a chance. And I desperately am longing for it. I want it. I feel like I'll do anything for it. And then you got it. Right? Like maybe you actually got it. And today, it's a good memory, but whatever it was did not satisfy for long. Right? Then it created a desire in you, right, to continue to pursue that feeling, right? Like you liked the feeling of getting it, of finally having it. But ultimately, what Ecclesiastes will tell us this morning is it probably has put you on one of two paths. One, it made you a cynic. Like, well, nothing satisfies me, right? Nothing matters. Right, you fit in line with Ecclesiastes. Or it puts you on a path of, I just want to pursue that the emotion of obtaining something, and there is pleasure, there is satisfaction, it's fleeting, so I'll have to do it again, and I'm just willing to do that over and over and over again. You haven't, for whatever reason, been exhausted by that yet. Or maybe for a handful of you, there was this liberating sense of like, oh, that was devastating. It didn't satisfy me at all. Okay. And you actually saw it as the grace that it was. That things aren't going to satisfy you. And maybe you've learned that lesson. And so there was some freedom in that and a grace in it, even though it was a bitter letdown, and it became both of those things. So we're going to pick up this morning in verse 12 of chapter 1. Just this kind of question of what satisfies, what is it that this morning, if you could snap your fingers and a difference, like a different amount of money, a different relationship, a different item, a different circumstance, a different locale, a different feeling, the return of something, if you could make it happen, what do you believe would satisfy you this morning? Let's pick up in chapter 1, verse 12. I, the preacher, have been king over Israel and Jerusalem. And I apply my heart to seek and to search out by wisdom all that is done under heaven. It's an unhappy business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. I've seen everything that is done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and striving after wind. What is crooked cannot be made straight, and what is lacking cannot be counted. I said in my heart, I have acquired great wisdom, surpassing all who were over Jerusalem before me. And my heart has had great experience of wisdom and knowledge. And I apply my heart to know wisdom and to know madness and folly. And I perceive that this also is but a striving after wind. For in much wisdom is much vexation. And he who increases knowledge increases sorrow. So what we have here, we're going to stop momentarily, is kind of this intro that we had the author last week, in the first 11 verses, kind of laid out, hey, here's what's going to happen in Ecclesiastes. This morning we're introduced to the preacher or the teacher, whatever you want to call them, who we now kind of have an opportunity to just see his journal laid open. Right? And so you're going to see his thoughts and his ramblings. You're going to see him make promises of what is going to come, and then he proves it. You'll see some proverbs sprinkled in. We see that in verse 15 and verse 18. And we just kind of see him struggle. He doesn't hold back any pretense of making sure that you think well of him. He's just very raw and honest here. So he begins by saying, listen, I want to find out what will satisfy me. And I have resources at hand. I have wisdom, I have knowledge, I have money, right? I'm going to go after this and see if I can find in this life what it is that will satisfy me. And he goes ahead and just kind of tells you the answer is not great, right? Verse 14, I've seen everything that is done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and striving after the wind. Verse 15, he leads with the proverb, what is crooked cannot be made straight, what is lacking cannot be counted. What he's saying here is the world is broken, right? Like, we know that it was created in perfect harmony with God and with man, and yet here he's saying, but it is seemingly irrevocably broken, disjointed. Like, we can't straighten it. We can see that it's broken. We can see that it's not right, but we can't fix it. We can't make there be more. We can't fix what is going on. And so he is going to just kind of lead us with this. We have in us a longing for God and a longing for something that is right and perfect. And yet this world is broken. We can't seem to fix it. Church, this morning, right, kind of the invitation that he's going to give us is, listen, you've got one shot at this life, right? And we live in a world where it's like, hey, give me one more try. Give me one more shot. Let me redo that. But life doesn't give us that opportunity. And so he's going to say, are you willing to learn from me, or are you going to have to learn the hard way? Are you going to have to do it yourself? And if you have multiple children, you probably have some that are willing to learn from others and some that it doesn't matter how much you keep them from the hard way. They're going to learn the hard way, right? That's just the way they're going to do it. Some of you are the ones that have to learn it the hard way. And as he tells us in 15, what is crooked cannot be made straight. He's reminding us, you can see things are jacked or broken, but you're not going to understand all the reasons why. And things are going to happen in this life that you will not get an explanation for on this side of heaven. Right? You're just not. You're going to say things like, what is crooked cannot be made straight. What is lacking cannot be counted. Like, there's just not a clear-cut answer or explanation. If you've seen someone come back from war, right, and they come back and they're like, I've seen things, I know things, I've experienced things, and they have a hard time readjusting. Someone who's gone and experienced maybe like in the medical field or a missionary field, right, extreme poverty or lack. Right, and they come back, we see this in verse 18. For in much wisdom is much vexation, and he who increases knowledge increases sorrow. Basically saying ignorance is bliss, right? Like, is what the king is saying here. He's like, when you know more, it increases your awareness of how much is broken and wrong. And yet we pursue wisdom as though it will fix things, right? So let's pick up in verse 1. He's going to begin his pursuit of looking for things to satisfy. I said in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasure. He's telling himself, whatever you want, you're going to get it. Enjoy yourself. But behold, this also is vanity. I said of laughter, it is mad. And of pleasure, what use is it? I searched with my heart how to cheer my body with wine, my heart still guiding me with wisdom. How to lay hold on folly, so I might see what was good for the children of man to do under heaven during the few days of their life. I made great works. I built houses. I planted vineyards for myself. I made myself gardens and parks and planted them all kinds of fruit trees. I made myself pools from which to water the forest of growing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had slaves who were born in my house. I had also great possessions of herds and flocks, more than any who had been before me in Jerusalem. I also gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and provinces. I got singers, both men and women, many concubines, the delight of the sons of man. So I became great and surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem, and my wisdom remained with me. And whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found pleasure in all my toil, and this was my reward for all my toil. Then I considered all that my hands had done, and the toil I had expended in doing it, and behold, all was vanity, striving after the wind, and there was nothing to be gained under the sun. He just begins to list out. He says, listen, it's almost like a hypothesis. Like, I'm going to just go and experience and do it. If I want to do it, I'm going to do it. And I have the means to do it. And so that I can figure out if there's anything that will actually fill this hole inside of me. And so we see him begin to just kind of work through. Verse 2, I said of laughter, right? But then he looks for humor. Like maybe it's in joy and jokes and it's humor. And we see that Proverbs also talks about laughter. This is Proverbs 14, 13. Even in laughter, the heart may ache, and the end of joy may be grief. Right? This reminder that you can laugh and also be grieving at the same time. That laughter doesn't fix our grief. And you can genuinely laugh and have joy and also be suffering and aching and hurting. We see also in Proverbs 26, verses 18 and 19. Like a madman who throws firebrands, arrows, and death is the man who deceives his neighbor and says, I'm only joking. Right? What Proverbs and Ecclesiastes are saying is humor has its place and it brings about joy. Right? But in the right context, at the right time, with the right content. Timing matters, right? And we all know someone who's an escapist, right? Like everything's a joke. And it helps them avoid reality. That nothing is serious. Nothing is off limits for their joking. And what it means is it actually ends up being like throwing like fire on someone, hurting someone, because in every moment they have got nothing of value or nothing of substance to say. It's simply a joke. And nothing's off limits to mock or to humiliate or to joke or to ridicule. So he's not saying that humor doesn't have its place. But he said, it's matter. Like, it has to have a place, and it's not the fix-all for every situation and for every circumstance. He goes in verse 3, I search with my heart how to cheer my body with wine. Like, he seeks out alcohol, going, okay, is there a way to handle my need for pleasure with alcohol? He goes, I even have my heart still guiding me with wisdom. He's like, I didn't completely lose control all the time. But it wasn't sufficient. In verse 4, I made great works. I built houses. I planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks. Like, this is a man with resources. He's not just going, I planted a rose bush. He's like, I changed the landscape. And I built architectural feats. And an oak, they need water. All right, let's move water there. Right, like we had a small example of this, right, with Tebow Pickens Ranch, right, where it's like, I'm just going to make an oasis, where it's not an oasis, with water, with trees, and with buildings, and this is being done on even a grander scale. One of the things we love about kids is the wonder that they have, right, like when they see something for the first time, right, and you're like, oh, yeah, like, it is incredible. I've lost that. That's awesome. And you'll hear yourself telling them, don't lose your wonder. And yet, we do. We lose our wonder. And he's saying, listen, I did all of these tremendous things, and they're good. They were artistic. Houses, vineyards, gardens, parks, fruit trees. Like, I've done it. It lost its luster. He continues, I made myself pools from which to water the forest of growing trees. Like, nature itself isn't enough. You almost get the impression here that he's trying to recreate Eden. Right? And he's going in and saying, all the fruit trees, all the water, all, like, I want to recreate what we lost and what has been broken from the beginning. I want to fix it. And he's like, we're not capable of doing that. We're not able to create Eden on this side of the fall. It's not by our hands to be able to do that. In verses 7 and 8, he talks about stuff and money. Listen, I had servants, slaves. They were born in my house. I had great possessions of herds and flocks more than any who had been before me. I gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and provinces. He's like, I had the stuff, not satisfied. Oh, so maybe it's physical pleasure. Right? I had many concubines, right? At his service to do his bidding and whatever he wanted. Right, we see that Solomon at one point had at least 1,000 women between wives and concubines. Right? It's like my choice, whatever I want, it's before me. I have access to it. I can't just like long for it. I've made it happen. And it's here. Art and music and beauty, like right? I have singers, men and women, a choir, like so you can imagine the day where he's just walking through his garden, right? Looking at the fruit trees, picking off fruit, seeing the water, looking at people walk around. I mean, they're just singing for his benefit. That's beautiful. And what you're singing and what I'm seeing, I've done this, I've got more money. Like, you can imagine all of it. And he's like, it's all right. And maybe for those of us who have less than that, we're like, he's a fool. And yet we know that when we've got what our heart has desired, it's not been sufficient. He's just done it on a greater, grander scale than us. So I became great and surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem. My wisdom remained with me. Whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found pleasure in all my toil, and this was the reward for all my toil. And then I considered it, and it was striving after rather, wasn't sufficient. He had the means and the resources to do it, and it wasn't enough. So this morning before us, we can say, okay, I don't think you did it right, I can do it better, so we can run after the same path. Or we can begin to glean wisdom from this. All right, let's continue in verse 12. So he says, I've done this, so let me try something else. So I turn to consider wisdom and madness and folly. Like, is there rule in the world? Is it better to be crazy? For what can the man do who comes after the king? Only what's already been done. Then I saw that there is more gain in wisdom than in folly. There's more gain in light than darkness. The wise man has eyes in his head. The fool walks in darkness. Yet I perceive that the same event happens to them. I said in my heart, what happens to the fool will happen to me also. Why have I been so wise? And I said in my heart that this also is vanity. For the wise as of the fool, there is no enduring remembrance, seeing that in the days to come, all will have long been forgotten. How the wise dies just like the fool. So I hated life, because what is done under the sun was grievous to me. For all his vanity and striving after wind, like you can see him going, I've been wise, like I've done the thing, and I'm going to die. And the guy who's done nothing, who's been a fool, he dies too. Like, there's no like reward or prize here that I get that he doesn't get. And so we begin to see death enter the equation. And so he tells us, listen, wisdom is better than foolishness. He says it is better. Right, there's more gain in verse 13 in wisdom than in folly. Just like we know there's more gain in light than in dark. It's like, okay, I'll give you that. It's better to be wise than to be a fool. But I'm still going to die. And so we see this great equalizer begin to enter. Death is coming. And my wisdom won't keep me from it. My pleasure won't keep me from it. My resources won't keep me from it. My knowledge won't keep me from it. And so we can bury our head in the sand and pretend like death isn't coming. But right this morning, even if we just say, hey, we're all going to die. Like, been in a long time. Right? Like, we quickly have the means of just kind of maneuvering away from that. Going, but, right? And he's saying, I'm going to die. And I've found nothing yet that satisfies me. He says, even the wise one, right, is going to be forgotten. Verse 16, for the wise as the fool, there's no enduring remembrance. A couple weeks ago, we had four generations in my family in a room. There was was 95 years separating my youngest from my grandfather's older sister who's still alive. 95 years, which is incredible. So as I was sitting there thinking, my grandfather was 95, still living, right? My kids, who are also alive in the room, know literally nothing about his dad, his mom. Right, like in four generations, right? Like they're sitting there going, this is my great-grandfather, right? I still have memories and thoughts, but his dad, like someone that would have been so close and such an intimate relationship for him, right? They're like, okay, no remembrance, none. And we can fool ourselves into believing that this moment in history is the most important moment, that it'll be different for us, but what he's saying is this, is there is no lasting remembrance. There is no lasting legacy. Eventually, it just becomes a name or a word at best. You're not remembered. You're forgotten. Right? Think about the big ranches in the Texas Panhandle that have sold recently. Right? Have left families or like you can imagine as they were being worked 100 years ago, no one was thinking, hey, at some point in the future, this won't even be in our family. Right? At some point in the future, the founder of this ranch will be like an asterisk in a history book. Right? Or a contract. Is someone else will own it. And it'll be forgotten. So the question for us is, do we live like we won't die? Or do we have an eye towards that? Right? Because Ecclesiastes can say there's going to be some wisdom in living towards this idea that the end is coming. Chapter 12 says, you will stand before God and there will be judgment. So it should affect the way that we navigate through life. Alright, he's gonna pursue one more thing here. Look at verse 18. After pleasure, after wisdom, he's going to pursue work. I hated all my toil in which I toil under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to the man who will come after me. And who knows whether he will be wise or a fool, yet he will be master of all which I toil and use my wisdom under the sun. This is also vanity. So I turned about and I gave my heart up to despair over all the toil of my labors under the sun. Because sometimes a person who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave everything to be enjoyed by someone who did not toil for it. This is vanity and a great evil. What is a man called the toil and striving apart from which he toils beneath the sun? For all his days are a sort of sorrow, are full of sorrow, and his work is a vexation. Even in the night his heart does not rest. This also is vanity. Right, like we're two chapters in. I'm glad y'all came back this week, right? Because there was like legitimate concern. Well, if it's vanity, I need to be there, right? And we know that this is being written prior to Jesus. But the danger for us this morning would be if we run too quickly to Jesus in this, and we don't sit in the reality of this, and if we don't realize that this is what our coworkers and our neighbors and people in the world are sensing and feeling, then we can become disengaged, right, from those who are asking really hard, big existential questions, or even finding answers for ourselves. And so he says, listen, pleasure wasn't enough. Wisdom was not enough because death is coming. And so he says, I just worked really hard. Right? And so here you think, well, it's because he was a hedonist. Maybe he should have just been more moral. But here he does the right thing. He does what we would say is the right thing, and it's not also sufficient. By his hands, he doesn't find the pleasure that he's longing for. So you can take this section of scripture, and we've seen people respond very, very differently from it. Some will go, okay, I'm going to work, and I'm going to pile up this big inheritance so that I can pass it on to my kids, so that I can pass it on to my grandkids, and set up my family for a long time. Generational changing wealth. And you'll see other people who are extremely wealthy say, oh, no. Generational wealth is a bad thing because you didn't work for it, so you're going to become a horrible person. And so you'll see folks who will say, well, I'll pay for your college, and then all the money goes away. Because you need to put in the energy and the effort. Right? And both of those ideas would kind of come from here of going, what's it matter? Like, I worked really hard and I was really smart and I did a good job. And someone else gets to enjoy it. And that guy might not even be a good dude. Right? He might not even be someone who will appreciate it. And you can imagine, you just say, this is a great evil. Like, you can just hear the discouragement and the vexation and the struggle here. You can see this idea at play in our society, especially in sports. And I'm not talking money. Right? You see a coach or a player win a championship in any sport, and immediately the question goes, what are you going to do next year? Like, there are major sports programs, they have like a 24-hour rule. Like, after you win something, you can celebrate for 24 hours, and then it's back to work. Like, you've just poured your blood, sweat, tears, grind. Like, you've lost, like, you've done all these things to win this thing, and you can't even enjoy it because the competition just continues. Right? Maybe you feel this at work. What have you done for me lately? Right? It's great that you did this last year, but you want to eat next week, right? So you better keep working. Right? You still need a paycheck. This idea that it's never enough, it's never sufficient. For all his days are full of sorrow, and his work is vexation. Even in the night, his heart does not rest. This also is vanity. So for you this morning, which of these things have you been seeking as a means of satisfaction? Is it pleasure? Is it something off that list up there, right, of laughter, alcohol, beauty, accomplishment, nature, music, money, stuff, sex? Like, is it something there? Is it wisdom? Has it been the effort of your hands and work? What is it? And maybe you're going, no, not me. My pursuit is Jesus. He's all that I need. He satisfies me. And people who would pursue something off these lists may look silly. They look silly. But were you ever in a room as a kid in a classroom where the teacher gave an instruction that was different than the normal rhythm? Right? So maybe you're taking an exam, and typically you would, finish your exam, you'd walk over and put it in the basket, go back to your seat and be quiet. But in that moment, the teacher says, all right, this morning, when you finish your exam, flip your paper over and sit at your table quietly until everyone's done. So you hear this clearly, right? And you finish, and you do that, and then you notice someone else get up and they go and put their paper where you normally want. You're like, oh, you dummy. And then another person does it. And another person does it. And then you start to like second guess yourself of like, did I miss here? Like, am I the one that's wrong? And then when you begin to realize you're in the minority, right? Even though you know what is right, you begin to mimic what someone else does. And it, as a third grader, it takes a lot of courage to be like, no, I know I'm a teacher, right? And most kids are going to get up and do what everyone else does. Right? And we can remember moments like that, and we can laugh about moments like that, and we'll say, we'll never do that as adults. And then we can pursue wealth and accomplishment and pleasure and all of these things going, no, that's not going to satisfy me, then Jesus will satisfy me. That won't. But everyone else is doing it. And then we just ease into it. Or we say, well, I'm going to stay over here on the edge of it, and then before you know it, you're full on pursuing these things. What you would have said would make you look silly. And now you're glad to do it because you don't want to be the one guy not doing it, the one woman not doing it. Yesterday I was at Tractor Supply, out there a little lot. And I was looking at something, and Jan and Jude were with me. And Jan goes and is like, hey Dad, find me. And he goes and hides, literally with stuff waist high. Okay? It was only waist high. And he turns his back to me, and he covers his eyes. And he's like, find me. And he's giggling the whole time, right? And I'm like, Janet, where are you? I can't see you. Where are you? And he's just cracking up, right? He's like, I can't see. And Jude is kind of like, you're really weird, right? Like, he's just kind of looking at me. Y'all are both weird, right? And so there was this like silliness of it, of like, you're not hiding what you think you're hiding. Like, you think you're doing something. When Carmen and I moved to Yemen, I tried to learn Arabic, and I tried to wear the clothes, and I tried to blend in as much as I can, and I wanted to be seen as an insider. But listen, I was 6'3", and white, around a bunch of guys who were like 5'8", and not white. Like, I wasn't blending in. And so I could either try really hard to blend in and fool myself and be like, right? Or everyone else is one, like, you're a fool. Or I could embrace the fact that that wasn't my home, and that I was traveling through, and because of that, it allowed me to have some conversations and some interactions and just to embrace that this isn't it. This isn't it for me. This isn't it. Yeah, I know I don't belong. Let's talk about it. And let's enjoy the experience. 1 Peter 2 tells us that this isn't our home. That we are traveling somewhere else. That this isn't it. That we are sojourners, aliens in this place on our way to heaven. And if we try to bury our heads in the sand and pursue pleasure in the way that the author of Ecclesiastes does, we will find ourselves also desperate in our journal saying, there is no joy, there is no satisfaction, there is only vexation and trouble. But when we begin to see that this isn't our home and we aren't built for this place, it allows us, right, to begin to see things for what they are. And listen to how he ends this. Look at verse 24. So there's nothing better for a person than he should eat and drink and find enjoyment in his toil. Right? He comes back around. This also I saw is from the hand of God. For apart from him, who can eat and who can have enjoyment? He says, listen, so eat and work and drink and enjoy it. Now listen, it's not going to be lasting. It's fleeting enjoyment. But just see it for what it is. It's from God. It's a good gift. And you can enjoy it. And if you're looking for it for eternal satisfaction, you will be sorely disappointed. But if you can just see it for what it is, good gifts from a good God who's creating a longing in you for more of him and less of that, then it can just be what it is. And so we're entering a season where everything around us is saying, you need this to have a good Christmas. You need this experience. You need to create this situation. You need these things, right? But And if we go there, then we wake up on the 26th and Christmas was what Christmas was. Or we can just let Christmas be what it is. A reminder that our heart is longing for something more. And this is pretty good too. It's just not lasting. It's just not sufficient. It's just not enough. So death is inevitable. Ecclesiastes is going to call us into, how do we enjoy what the world has to offer without seeking for it to satisfy? Right? And live for something more permanent. We can either be devastated by this news this morning, or we can be liberated that these things don't satisfy. We can become a cynic, or we can just let them be what they are. And so the twin truths are this. We live in a broken world, and this broken world is not our home. Both of those things are true this morning. That there's going to be brokenness around us until we are with Jesus for all time. And so we can enjoy and be satisfied, and we can also, there's horrible things going on. In that, we can live in a broken world and also not be alone, because his mercy is new every morning, and he is Emmanuel, God with us. And so whether your circumstances this morning are devastating and hard, he is faithful and he is with you, and he will see you through. And if your circumstances are glorious and joyful, and you want nothing more for them not to change, they're going to change. And Jesus is with you, and he's for you, and you're not alone, and his mercy will be new every morning. And so we become a people in Ecclesiastes who mourn and grieve at what we see, but not as those without hope. Right? Like that begins to make sense to us. The broken world, not our final place. And so, like Paul, we can have abundance and see that Jesus is sufficient, and we can have lack in Philippians 4. See that Jesus is sufficient. That's why he would write to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 15:58 and say, you can labor and your labor will not be in vain. He contradicts Ecclesiastes, right? He says, if your labor is for the Lord, right? Then you can begin to see that things aren't in vain, that there's meaning to them when they're given a God-focused view. And then we can begin, right, as we go in this book, to be reminded that Jesus stepped into a broken world. And when he touched things, he restored them. When he touched sick people, health came. When he spoke life over death, life came. When he told the storm to be still, it was still. Like the raging, roaring, broken world that could not be straightened by us can be straightened by Jesus. And so listen, let's not hold one of those only. If we only hold that Jesus fixes everything, which is true, right? Here's who we become. This is where we're going to end. This is Proverbs 25, verse 20. We can take a truth like this and become this guy. Whoever sings songs to a heavy heart is like the one who takes off a garment on a cold day and like vinegar on soda. Right? He's saying, if you become the one that only wants to will the truth when someone is hurting, you hurt them. But it's true. And so we need to be able to sit in pain and discomfort and observe and see, you're right. It's a broken world that's not straight. But we know the one who makes it straight. And those twin truths are necessary for us to not lose hope and to not be a jerk. We need both of them. We are being invited in Ecclesiastes to call the world what it is. And to see that Jesus is sufficient to navigate us through. All right, we're going to need the whole book. All right, that's where we're headed. Let's pray this morning. Jesus, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for heavy things, God, that make us uncomfortable, that can make us squirm, and yet that they're needed so that we're not burying our heads in the sand. God, when we come to grips with the fact that you are faithful and sufficient, God, that we need you because you're the only one who will satisfy us. You are the bread that we need. You are the water that we need. God, it was through your blood that was spilled, and your body that was crushed, that we have hope and joy, and that we don't grieve and groan as those without hope this morning. God, so when you speak, when you call, God, will we allow the things that we're pursuing other than you to be bitter in our mouth, so that we'll be liberated from pursuing them. God, and help us to enjoy the ordinary things of life, because your grace is from you too. But we need you. In Jesus' name, amen. As the band sings and plays this morning, if you sit, if you stand, and let the Spirit move, and if you pray, do that. There'll be folks in the back of the room if you need someone to talk to. The Lord's Supper is also set up for those this morning who are in Christ. Who want to be reminded of why you have hope in your groaning. It was that your blood wasn't spilled, that your body wasn't broken, but His was on our behalf. And so we are a joyful people in the midst of a broken world this morning, because of Jesus.
Stand or sit with us. Let's respond together to the Lord this morning.
identity or his value in religious activity. And yet after he met Jesus, he would say, I've counted all things lost and be with the surpassing knowledge of knowing Christ Jesus our Lord. And as Jeremy already referenced, he would say, I found the secret to being content in any situation, having lunch or having little. And that secret to contentment was walking intimately and closely with Jesus. And so this morning, you might be feeling your range of emotions after that sermon, after that passage. It might be that you're thinking, oh my goodness, like everything that I'm headed toward, that I'm going toward, it actually is meaningless. It's striving after wind. What a grace to the Lord be reminded of that this morning, that we might adjust our gaze back on Jesus who actually satisfies and makes us content. And if this morning, if things aren't going well for you, if you're feeling mortality because of sickness, or financially, or otherwise, relationally, things aren't going well, what a grace to be reminded that Jesus is the one whom we're supposed to fix our gaze upon, that all of these other things are actually secondary and passing away. Let's pray to that end this morning, that Jesus would just be real to us, that we could walk with him in such an intimate and close way, that he would be the thing that would satisfy our deepest desires. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for reminding us this morning of what's important. Will you help us to walk with you more closely? Will you be real to us this morning in a way and moving forward that you've never been before? Will you loosen our grip on worldly things, on our expectation of what you can give us? And will you please just allow us to enjoy you? We pray all this in your name, Jesus.